Thank you for being here. Just a brief what I'll be talking about today, about Near East Relief, how the orphans got there, my journey with the orphan drug, the Ghazir girls orphanage, the White House declines the loan of the rug, why the rug factory, what are rugs associated with, and Congressman Adam Schiff declares the orphan rug to be displayed, Washington DC press conference and the national at the National Club, and the White House Visitor Center. A lot of you were not able to attend. Today you're going to have a chance to be there. And a few other surprises. I'm going to go quickly to the Near East part, Near East Relief part, because Vanna already did that. April 24, 1915, the American Embassy in Turkey is alarmed by the arrest of an imprisonment of over 200 Armenian intellectuals. But something very special that he did, Ambassador Morgenthau, the US ambassador, was that he sent a telegram to the State Department, to William Jennings Bryan. Destruction of Armenian race in Turkey is progressing. Will you suggest to Cleveland Dodd, Charles Crane, John Mott, Rabbi Stephen Wise, and others to form a committee to raise funds and provide means to save some of the Armenians. It is that specific telegram which initiated the Near East Relief. 2 weeks after this call, these gentlemen got together with the US State Department and they formed a committee called American Committee for Armenian and Syrian Relief. And they raised $60,000 the first 2 weeks and sent over to Ambassador Morgenthau to save the Armenians. In 1918, the committee was renamed to Armenian and Syrian Relief, to American Committee for Relief in the Near East, probably because the Turks put pressure not to use the word Armenian. And finally, in 1919, the Near East Relief became an act of US Congress incorporation. They raised $117 million, equivalent to roughly $3 billion in today's dollar. That's an amazing amount to save 132,556 Armenian children in Greece, in Alexandropol, in Yerevan, in Syria, in Lebanon, in Palestine, and everywhere else. Look at this map. This is the Near East Relief map in Turkey itself. Every single star that you see is an orphanage. And this is Istanbul, Constantinople, and Kharkiv, Caesarea, Arabgir, Angara, you name it, all the way to Syria, Lebanon, Palestine, Iraq, and then into Gars and in Yerevan. What I show this map for is what happened after the end of 1922. All these orphanages had to be moved out. The two faces of the same coin. Talat, in January 1915, he said, there is room only for Turks in Turkey, basically identifying his enemies. So, Assyrians, Armenians, Jews, and Arabs were highlighted as enemies. And only in late 1922, according to New York Near East Relief Bureau, Kemalist instruction, all Christians must be evacuated Turkish territory. Near East Relief had to move 22,000 orphans out of Turkey. All those orphanages that you saw. And this is only one track where Jakob Kunstler, a Swiss missionary working for the Near East Relief, entitled Papa, because because he had so many children to look after. He moved 5,000 Armenian Greek orphans from Harper, brought them to Syria and Lebanon. A trip, 513 miles, because the Turks will not allow them to go down to Mersin, load them on boats or ships and bring them to Syria and Lebanon. They have to walk. These are the arabas, or the carriages. See the children packed with hoodies on their head? And this is Mrs. Kunstler with an umbrella under the sun, making sure all the movement of children. At one point were with the arabas, with the carriages. And then they were on mules. Look at that picture. Boxes around the mules, because the kids could not walk. We're talking about 4 or 5 year old children all the way to 15 and 16 and 18. They had to walk, so they put them in boxes. As the other ones got tired, they moved them around. My journey with your Armenian orphan rock started May 2005 in Beirut, Lebanon. A friend of mine, Sasun Simonian, brought me an Armenian book, and he said, I got this book at the flea market for 25 cents. Here, take it. I know you are into this stuff. By then, I was deeply involved in my research in American orphanages established in the Middle East. The Armenian book was printed in 1946, celebrating Jakob Kunstler, a Swiss missionary, and his 40 years of dedicated service to humanity, saving Armenians all the way from Urfa into Turkey and Syria and Lebanon. As I quickly scanned the pages, the headline caught my eye: The Rug Factory. November 2005, after days of combing the Ghazir village and searching the streets for an historic building, I suddenly caught a glimpse of a building with a majestic arches. I held my breath and silently kept on walking into the courtyard. There it was, the full sight of the arches and the beautiful water fountain. I knew I had found the Near East Ghazir orphanage. At this magnificent courtyard, a few weeks later, I visited the Ghazir girls orphanage with a small team of CNN cameramen and recorded the story of the special drug.
Next is the story of a rug that had roots in the controversial killings of Armenians back in 1915. Details on this from Future TV in Lebanon.
When this picture was taken in December 1925, the main feature was not US President Calvin Coolidge on the left-hand side, but the carpet these officials were showing off. What makes this rug special? The 4x6 meter rug had just crossed two oceans, arriving from a tiny Lebanese village, where it was hand-woven by Armenian orphans as a token of gratitude to the US. The 1915 Armenian genocide cost more than 1 million lives and a mass exodus to surrounding countries, notably Syria and Lebanon. Among the thousands of Armenians that settled in Lebanon were some 132,000 orphans. This was the first home to 1,400 Armenian orphans. But this orphanage, one of many funded by the US's Near East Relief, later moved to the mountainous village of Ghazir, north of the capital. According to Misak Kenejan, a researcher of Armenian history, the US government had provided $91 million in donations and about $25 million worth of food supplies for all the Armenian orphans in Lebanon. In 1925, the orphanage received enough money by the Near East Relief to purchase 4 weaving machines. In less than 10 years, the girls at the Ghazir orphanage wove 3,240 rugs, but the largest by far was the one which made its way to the White House.
It was taken from a German museum in Dresden, and it was copied from there. But the idea is there are 144 animals on that carpet. The idea is because where Armenia and Mount Ararat and Van is what you call is where the Garden of Eden was, according to Bible.
Every 21st Sunday of December, the Near East Relief Association organized what was dubbed as Golden Rule Day, dedicated to raising donations. It is exactly here that this picture was taken over 6 decades ago. Donations helped thousands of orphans become the pillar of the Armenian community in Lebanon, allowing Ghazir to blossom into an integral part of the country's Armenian heritage. Sara Khoury, Future Television, Ghazir.
Remember the water fountain. As soon as this was broadcast and newspapers in Lebanon talked about the broadcast, I got a phone call. A lady tells me that her grandfather had 2 rugs from Ghazir. Would you come and make sure which one is the one which looks like the one in the White House? My heart was pounding. I wanted to go and see the rug. Dr. Khosrov Krikorian was an AUB medical doctor, and he looked after the orphan girls from the Near East Relief staff. But during the war, his sister, who had the 2 rugs, she was attacked by a knife and killed. And one of the rugs was stolen. They asked me to identify if this was the one which looked similar to the White House rug. And it does. With the animals, I mean, each rug is different. I'm not the rug expert. I couldn't tell the Tabriz, a Caucasian one, different. But by just looking at it, it looks very similar. And this is the White House rug part number 982-1511.1. It's John Coolidge. After his dad took the rug in 1982, he returned it back to the White House. And this is the reference number. It's a magnificent rug. 11.7 by 18.11 feet rug, woven 4.4 million individual hand-tied knots. The solemn expression of pain and sorrow for everything lost, homeland, loved ones, and trust in humanity. December 1925, the rug was presented to the United States President Calvin Coolidge as in Golden Rule gratitude. The rug was returned in 1982. And it was displayed November 2014. It all started when the Armenian Cultural Foundation in Massachusetts organized displaying the book by Hagop Martin Deranian. The White House declined the request by the Armenian community to display the orphan rug at the Smithsonian, where the book was going to be released. And they said it was not considered an appropriate venue. Not a single Armenian American to date believes that the book signing, where the subject of the book is about the story of the rug itself being displayed, was inappropriate or any reason for refusal. This was an insult to the intelligence of Armenian American community at large. The community is still wondering whose dust we were sweeping under the table, literally. Where is Ghazir? Ghazir is in a country called Lebanon, 16 miles from Beirut. After you pass Junia, that's where Ghazir is. And on the highway, there's a sign, it says Ghazir. Perched on a hill, the Mazar Palace in Ghazir was built on 19th century by a Lebanese prince, Emir Shahab, as a birth gift to his nephew. In 1975, the palace was classified as Lebanese historical monument. At an elevation of 1,246 above sea level, 16 miles from Beirut, Lebanon, with a magnificent view of the Mediterranean, as you can see. This was the girls' orphanage. There were 14 of them. This is one of them. In Ghazir, all 14 in Ghazir, by the way. And this is where in 1923, 1,400 Armenian girls found home under the American flag. This is how it was, and this is how I found it in 2005. Why the rug factory? By a rule mandated by Near East Relief, Ghazir orphans had to leave orphanage as soon as they turned 16. Papa, Jakob Kunstler, by now the director of the orphanage, and his wife, Elizabeth, who, by the way, was an Ethiopian princess. Yes, an Ethiopian princess looking after Armenian orphans. Worried about the orphan girls not having the skills to become self-sufficient, or in the absence of any other employable skills, ending up in houses as maids. Collaborated with Ohannes Taşçıyan, a rug merchant from Urfa, Turkey, to establish a rug weaving factory, where the girls to develop the art and science of weaving rugs and be able to self-finance their livelihood, both inside and outside the orphanage. Jakob Kunstler needed money. He asked for $1,000 to buy 10 looms, weaving looms, and Near East Relief gave only 400. They bought four as a pilot project, and eventually it became a $25,000 project. This is the rug factory, as the girls are working there. Ovanes Taşçıyan, the expert, where he took for large rugs, and four at a time, girls will sit, and each knot, they will tie it together. Everybody was involved. Even an orphan without hands. She's using her feet to prepare wool threads for the rug. Her name is Maireni. Papa Kunstler, overlooking how the girl looking at the pattern and weaving the rug and tying knots. 3 years after the Ghazir orphanage was founded, and within a period of 10 months, seven Armenian orphan girls, on behalf of tens of thousands of Armenian orphans around the world, wove their masterpiece, a beautiful artifact, the hidden in the delicacy of its warps and threads and the sophistication of its bright colors, which they used vegetable dyes to dye those wools in different colors, reds and blues and yellows. The treasure of 4,000-year-old culture, the solemn expression of pain and sorrow for everything lost, the homeland, loved ones, trust in humanity, tears of joy and gratitude for a newly captured hope, and an unexpected love found in Americans that stood by them until they could exhale again. This is the rug on the right. The rug factory is here. They hung it to show demo before they shipped it. And this is how it looks in color. It arrived December 1925. This is at the White House, President Calvin Coolidge and Dr. Finley of the Near East Relief. And this is what Dr. Finley said while standing on the rug. What a task it was to be known from the fact that they tied 4.4 million knots in its making, but it was a labor of love. They have tied onto it the gratitude of tens of thousands of children to you and to America, and what they have tied into it will never be untied. It is sent to adorn the dearest of our temples, the White House of our president. What does it take to tie 4.4 million knots in the rug? I have found this footage where the orphan girls themselves are weaving the rug. This is in Ghazir. They're going for a promenade after the moonwalk with little branch trees because they're happy outside the orphanage. One tie, two knots, three, four, five, six, seven, there you go. The 4.4 million nuts were done this way. And you see them in the factory, the girls are sitting on bags, the looms they're working on. These are the wools that they dyed themselves under the patronage of Mr. Tashcha, or Ms. Tashcha. Isn't this amazing? It's not a story, you can see them working. There you go, the water fountain. One of them is going to fall. And then Papa Counselor is going to come over. There he is. Here he has lost his arm. Looking after an Armenian orphan, he got, you know, infected. And they have to amputate his right arm. And here the girls are dancing, so their traumas are forgotten because they have seen their parents beheaded and killed. This is from a German archive that I unearthed, and that's going to show you some more. Again, older girls are walking right now, and this is in Lebanon, the Bay of Junier, the Mediterranean. And then, Aeroport International de Beirut, it's Lebanese airport with the star on it. These are boxes, Christmas gift boxes they're receiving. Papa Kunzler with the kid. They're happy. Somebody is thinking of them hundreds of miles and thousands of miles away. They have a Christmas tree. Papa Kunzler, his wife, Elizabeth, and his daughter. Well, on this question, business card. From 1923 to 1930, the orphanage produced 3,240 rugs. That's a lot of rugs. And around 1,000 orphan girls were certified as art of rug weaving. These girls made history to introduce the art of rug weaving into the Lebanese culture. And in 1929, the whole Lebanese parliament members went out to Ghazir to congratulate these girls that they brought this culture into Lebanon. And one by one, as in 1930, when Near East Relief stopped, it's after 15 years, and Mr. Oannes Tashcan took some of the girls, he opened his own factory, and moved as the girls got, they grew older and they started making their own families. But while this was happening, in 1924, an advertisement in the Near East, the new Near East magazine, reads the following. Ravishing rugs, rugs of the soft, rich color of the East that mellow with use, woven in patterns of ancient and intricate design, are on sale at the industrial looms of Near East Relief. These rugs are to be had at cost, in some instances as less than their cost. The reason for this is that they have been woven by orphanage children who are being trained by competent instructors for self-support. They are not being put on the American market as a commercial project. The rugs range in size, 3 feet by six, 10 feet by 14, and look at the prices. They were $20 to $400. And $400 of that time in 1924 is the equivalent of $5,500. As the girls, they grew older, you can see their clothing is different. They're beautiful ladies. They're weighing wool to decide what's the weight of the carpet is going to be. And and here in the rug factory. And here is Hayganush Chifigian's. This is to certify that Hayganush Chifigian was one of the best rug weavers. She learned the trade in our factory. She is leaving the institution for matrimonial purposes. Mohamed Sascha, chief manager of the rug factory. Jakob Kunstler, director of the orphanage. These are diplomas that, you know, exit paper that they were given. Now, rugs were used in different uses, but rugs as trophies? Born in 1899, Harpert, deported to Deir ez-Zor and then to Ras Al Ain. Graduate of American University of Beirut in 1923, dentist for thousands of orphans, zealous for mouth cleaning. And he was telling them that the contest, a clean tooth never decays. Designer of inter-orphanage mouth cleaning contest, carpet award. Dr. Harutun Sarabian. The contest was performed every 6 months. There were, I said, over a dozen orphanages across Lebanon. And here is another Ghazir rug. American Near East Relief Inter-Orphanage Mouth Cleanliness Contest. The NER Silver Star, which was the logo for, and then NER, a clean tooth never decays. Sidon, another orphanage. Ghazir, Jubain, and Antilles. And this was woven in 1925. The original was sent to American Dental Association in America. And today, this is the second one. There's two of them made. This is Dr. Sarabian's son who has it, and the other one, which was sent to ADA, American Dental Association, is in Alma, in Watertown, Massachusetts, at the museum. And this original card is the contest. Who won? July 1925. It was signed in Bird's Nest. January 26th, St. Folks. So whoever had the cleanest teeth will keep that, I mean, overall the orphanage will keep that rug as a trophy for 6 months. What is the Mazar Palace used today for? Wedding halls. This is a map. Ghazir, how to get there. And this is the Palais du Mazar, the Mazar Palace. On the left are the orphans. On the right, it is set up for a wedding ceremony. This is how it looks when it's empty. There's no wedding ceremony. And this is how it looks when it's ready for a wedding party. And the water fountain is used as kind of table to display all kind of good food. The difference between day and night, dancing floor, chairs, lighting. November 2014, I was there and I flew from Los Angeles to Beirut to Ghazir, and 2 weeks later I flew to Washington DC to see the palace. This is the orphanage, how it looked only in November 2014. The blue Mediterranean in the back, and look at this picture. This is at night, same place, okay? Same angle even, with a big display, wedding party, dancing floor, and all kinds of party events. This is the rug factory. This building here, and all the way back to the end of the street, was the rug factory. I have located the actual rug factory because of the windows. You see? And these are the arches, which are here. But every few years when I go there, I always visit and capture as things change. November 2014, when I went, it has become a bank. This is where it was, You know, here it is. The rug was hanging exactly from over the arches. Okay? But I visited Ghazir maybe 6-7 times. Every time I went up and knocked the door, and you know, the building where I'm photographing the same angle at that time, whoever photographed it, I wanted to take the same angle, and I couldn't. Nobody was at house. Keep trying, keep trying. This time I was successful. I got to the building so I can take the photo. And I'm going to show you from the building where I took the photo. This is where it was hung from. And it's a bad, people are working there, right? This is where the White House rug was hung from before it was sent to the White House. And where I went into the building where I'm photographing is the owner of that rug factory today. And I kept on asking him, do you have any rugs? Another one. He says, yes, I have one from my grandfather. So, just to give you an idea. So I was very happy to be able to go up there. And he found the rug, and I said, I gotta touch it. But just think, this owner of the rug factory today, it's not a rug factory, it's just a bunch of apartments that he had. All these, look at these colors. All these wools have been dyed by the orphans themselves. He took me where the factory was, where they used to dye the wool. It is amazing. And this is when the Ghazir rug was privately displayed at the White House. Bartoli Hovsepian, or Gulesian, one of the 7 orphans who wove the rug back in 1925, in 1986, she's sitting on a chair on top of the rug. I want to know what she felt. Congressman Adam Schiff declared on April 30th that Armenian orphan rug is to be displayed after it was stopped initially. So Washington DC on Tuesday, November 18, and I'm taking you to the steps because you were not there. I'm going to show you what happened there. So hosted a press conference at the National Press Club to mark the opening of the White House display at the Armenian Orphan Rug, also known as the Ghazir Rug. Congressman Adam Schiff, Congressman David Velodeo, and other congressman members spoke there, as well as Dr. Martin Deranian, the author of the book, Aram Haparian of the ANCA, Brian Arduni of the Armenian Assembly of America, and Harach Gezubegian from the Armenian Rug Society. And I don't know, maybe Harach is here. He's not. So he spoke as well as I spoke as an independent researcher. And this was at the press club.
World War, it still made headlines around the world and prompted an outpouring of sympathy and money. $110 million, an amount equivalent to billions in today's currency. Making the rug required 4 million hand-tied knots. So when you see it this morning, you should know that each one of the knots was made by a child who lost her family in the slaughter, but had somehow made her way to the Ghazir orphanage where her life was saved by American generosity. It's that simple. Without the American people, there would be no Ghazir rug, and every American should feel a deep sense of pride in knowing its history. But this, thank you, Harach. I know that Harach traveled here from California, along with Joseph Bezjan and Alexei Bezjan. They're active in the Armenian Rug Society, one of the great organizations of the Armenian American community. Our final speaker for today is Misak Leshadu, who has
as Hotch noted, has done research not just on the rug itself, but on the broader Near East relief effort, which was, again, as I mentioned earlier, this epic introduction of America onto the world stage as a humanitarian power. It's an unknown history, and one that I think we all need to do a better job of sharing. Isaac has been a great contributor to that effort. Thank you, Isaac.
So this was the press conference before we walked to the White House.
Today I bring you the voices of those orphans. I bring you their joy and appreciation that the rug is finally being displayed. While Dr. Duranian was introducing his book on the orphan rug, and U.S. Congressman Adam Schiff and others have been adamantly persisting in dismaying it proudly at the Capitol, as a researcher, I took a totally different route. Exactly 16 days ago, today, I flew 7,500 miles from Los Angeles all the way to Lebanon, and specifically to the village of Ghazir, where the rug was woven. 16 miles from Beirut, perched on a hill overlooking the Mediterranean, the Mazar Palace in Ghazir was built during the 19th century by a Lebanese prince. Early in the 1920s, the American Near East Relief rented the palace and turned it into a girls' orphanage, the largest in the area. There were 14 other orphanages in Ghazir. Under the American flag, which unfortunately doesn't fly right now, the 1,400 Armenian girls who had witnessed the destruction of their race, their world, their country, and their entire childhood lived in here. The compassion and the commitment to make a difference on the part of the American people was overwhelming. All three American first ladies, Wilson, Harding, Coolidge, adopted Armenian children. Why would they adopt Armenian children? What happened to their parents? Three consecutive first ladies. American kids sold lemonade on the streets, popcorn, cookies, to earn in America and give in Armenia. This was the law. Children with disabilities lined up with their piggy banks to donate for Near East relief. The whole nation was acting in a dynamic rhythm, the rhythm of intolerance for crimes against humanity. The Ghazir orphanage was a success story because of the commitment of the U.S. government, the Near East Relief volunteers, missionaries, and the American people, all nationwide, to justice for crimes against humanity. Near East Relief started as a committee in 1915 because of Ambassador Henry Morgenthau's call, the destruction of Armenian race. Near East Relief did not exist out of nowhere because of his insistence it existed, and in 1915 too. The refusal of the display of the rug is not an Armenian issue. It is an American issue. The refusal to display the rug is the denial of one of the most beautiful chapters of American history. 15 consecutive years, three U.S. presidents were the testament of our forefathers' commitment to who we are as a nation, truly, are and what really democracy and philosophy is all about. The Americans were the unsung heroes for 132,556 Armenian orphans until they found a common language. Their language and medium was to express their essential eternal gratitude for what was given to them. They carefully wove the lyrics of their poetry in the impeccable craftsmanship and the intricate design of a jewel promised by President Coolidge to be placed in the White House. The American people changed the destiny of the remnants of the Armenian orphans, the survivors of the Armenian genocide. Thank you very much.
And from there, everybody just walked.
First, welcome to our program here.
Your own box. This is where it was displayed. Give you an idea how it looks inside. I'll take you there too. While nobody was there, it was three artifacts. Small display, a French vase from Seb, and a Japanese cherry branch, and this was it. It was on a pedestal. You didn't even, couldn't see what the patterns were. It said, the headline said, thank you to the United States, three gifts to President in gratitude for American generosity abroad. The exhibit displayed three objects gifted to American presidents in response of American aid after international catastrophe. You know, Metzielem, great catastrophe, you know, calamity. So you can see the words, how it was programmed. The Armenian orphan rug, the French vase, presented to Herbert Hoover, President Herbert Hoover, and Japanese cherry and dogwood blossom encased in acrylic box given to President Obama after the tsunami. This is the French vase, but it's interesting, it's from Sèvres, like Sèvres Tashnakir, so that's where it's from. And this is the cherry blossom, because of the help the Americans gave to the tsunami effect. The way the rug was displayed is an insult to the intelligence of the Armenian-American community. No proper lighting, dark corner. Rug should have been hung on the wall. Rug was not completely even unwrapped. Part of it was rolled over. Visitors could not properly see the patterns on the rug. Kids could only see the sides of the rug. The rug should be displayed across the country for people to have a chance to see it. Less than a week is too short, you know, at the White House Visiting Center. The display caption for the rug was criticized for avoiding mention of the Armenian genocide and failing to explain who these orphans were, where did they come from, why were they orphaned, who made them orphans, or what was done or not done to set things straight. And there were many errors in the explanation. I had to go to Best Buy and buy a monopod so I can photograph, because this rug is going to go back to White House. God knows when we're going to see it again. And there was no proper way. So I ended up walking back and forward and blindly photographing whatever I hit. I did it maybe 20, 30 times until I catch one with a good way.
Kids and parents were in protest that they could not see. Yes, they finally displayed the rug, but it was at a court, there was no even light on it. So any kid at this height will only see the sight, and the parents as well. The rug obviously had a label in the back, in golden rule gratitude, as Vanna explained. I don't have to repeat it again. But here it is. You even will see it better than many of the people who visited it. So I'm holding the monopod up there, blindly not knowing where I'm shooting. Because I want to capture the animals, I want to capture the design. So many animals, unicorns, horses, lions. In the 2005, in my research, I thought there was 144 animals. There's even more. Look, each one is a lion here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, each one. Unicorns, designed here, again. Here, birds, leopards and all kinds of tigers. So nobody saw this because of the height issue. See, each one, there's an animal, and here too, and here too. And the most beautiful part, the granddaughters of Papa Kunzler. They flew from Switzerland, from San Francisco, from San Diego, from United Kingdom, to see the rug and hear about the rug, because they didn't have much information about it. I mean, they had, but not enough. So here, I am showing them on my phone some of the pictures that I've captured in Ghazir. And what a beautiful picture with the granddaughters with the rug in back. And one of them, Annie, from UK, her brother was born in this house. That's Papa Kunstler's house in Ghazir. This is how it looks today. Amal Ramzi Clooney, Nea Alameddin, is a London-based Lebanese-British lawyer specializing in international law, human rights and extradition. She is representing Armenia's interest in the landmark trial before the European Court of Human Rights. And as you know, Harut Sasunyan wrote about her and what she did. And Khalil and Najib Alameddin were first cousins. Their fathers were brothers. Khalil had a son called Ramzi, who is Amal's George Clooney's wife, Amal's father. And on the other side, Najib married Aida Kunstler, or Aida Alameddin, and had four children, Rima, Makram, Aida, and Karim. Aida is Papa Kunstler's daughter. And here is Ani. A beautiful explanation how her brother was born in that house.
In every one of them, coming off together. So, what do you want me to say? Now, right, my mother.
What do you remember?
Who's
your mother?
My mother was Marta, and she married an Englishman, and she was 8 months pregnant with my little brother, who wasn't born yet, and we lived in the Sudan, and she came back to have a baby with her mother and father. And the night before, we were in the garden where you say it's all now sort of wine rubbish, but there was green gage trees there, and pomegranate trees, and academia trees.
I don't know what it is.
We know exactly. my mother was climbing this green gate tree. She was huge. You know, and the other sisters, Auntie Ida, Auntie Martha, and Mandy, were sitting saying, Martha, be careful, come down, come down. No, I want to get these wonderful green gauges. She got them down. Anyway, that night, at 8 o'clock at night, I heard this. So I got out of bed, and I was walking out, saying, where's Mummy? You know, what happened? And Auntie Mandy came out and said, she's in there with Auntie Ida, who's delivering the baby, and she's on the kitchen table.
How old were you again?
I was 12.
Okay. She was 12 in Ghazir.
She was, this was in
seeing her
in
brother
Ghazir.
Born.
And
yet another rug. This is Papa's other daughter, the only living one. She's 98. She's in San Diego, Elizabeth Marshall. This is another rug. She chose the color of the rug when she was 7 years old. And she is here. This is Papa Kunstler, Elizabeth, the daughter's brother, and this is Elega. And she has this rug in San Diego. Again, you can tell the animals are very similar. She's here when she was a kid in Ghazir, and there's a label in the back as well. And this is how the Ghazir rug looks and at the White House rug looks like. Rugs and rockets.
أهلا بكم في متحف المادة اليوناني للصواريخ Lebanese Rocket Society.
The Lebanese dream one day of conquering space, impossible to believe. And yet at the very beginning of the 60s, while NASA in the United States was readying to send Apollo, Manouk Manoukian and the students of the modest Hagazian College launched rockets into the Lebanese sky.
This is the very beginning of what started from scratch with tiny little rockets.
It was an enormous accomplishment.
The space project turned into a national patriotic adventure.
I looked at my students and said, now we can look at larger rockets.
The boys and their rockets were a good story.
And at that point, we decided to call it the Lebanese Rocket Society.
Possible that we've never heard about it.
I was very leery of the rocket project.
Our rocket had a very long range, which I assumed concerned countries surrounding Lebanon.
Israelis were looking at it, and Syrians were looking at it, and everybody was looking at it. I thought, this is something that has to stop.
The world then was a world of possibilities, to dream and believe it.
طلعوا لي الصورة بقول أنا شو كاين نسيم بس مصور الضخام ماشي ما في صار
What is that got to do with rugs, right? This is Professor Manoukian, Manouk Manoukian from the Hagazian. It used to be college then and a university right now. As you heard in the 60s, they made rockets. It was in 2009, December 24, the night of Christmas. I flew in from Kuwait because I was serving there in the US Army base. And Joanna Haji Thomas and Khalil Jureish wanted to interview me. These are stamps commemorating the Lebanese rocket. And they were telling me, you know, tell us what the Armenians did. It is amazing, it's rockets and all this and that. And I told them the Ghazir rug story at the White House. He says, what? There's a white, in the White House, a rug made in Ghazir? I said, yeah. And then they made an interview and all that and stuff. And this Rocket Society information and how. And here it is, the stamp. And this is all the rug story of the White House.
But they were so intrigued with the story of how Armenian orphan girls who just survived, they built this humongous rock in the White House. They were smart enough. They went to Armenia. They did similar size using the rock. This is a rug. It's woven in Armenia. And this is part of the exhibition. So this is Khalil Jrej and his wife, Professor Manuk Manukyan from Florida, and Dr. Paul Haygazyan, president of Haygazyan University. And here's a replica of the rocket right at the entrance in Haygazyan, in Lebanon, Beirut, today. And here's the rug. So now you know rockets and drugs. One always wonders, is the 1925 Ghazir orphan drug the only Armenian gift drug to the White House? What do you think? No? So how come nobody has spoken about it? Teddy Roosevelt, 2 weeks before leaving office, on behalf of the nation, received a handsome Persian rug by H.H. Topakian of New York. The rug was mounted in a mahogany frame and is now being exhibited in the White House corridor at Washington in 1909. And this is the thank you letter where he says, I take the pleasure in accepting on behalf of the government the gift of this beautiful jeweled rug. Not a rug, jeweled rug, which you delivered at the White House today. It will be hung there with many thanks. Believe me, sincerely, Teddy Roosevelt, 26th president. Haygazun Hovhannes Topakian, born in Kayseri, Caesarea, Turkey in 1864, Persian consul general in New York City, February 17, 1909. An oriental rug was presented as a permanent gift to the White House today. H.H. Topakian, Persian commissioner and rug collector of New York, the rug was formally accepted by the president on behalf of himself and his successors in the White House. It has been suspended in an 8-foot mahogany frame and stand upright as screened, and is being screened with the executive offices. It is woven of the costliest silk and studded with precious stones. It has wide fringe of pearls and the silk knots, emeralds, rubies, turquoise, and in the center are arranged in floral design. The background of the ivory is ivory white and the woven flowers are in the softer shades of rose, blue and green. The rug is about 6.5 by 4.5 feet long. It was valued as $50,000 in 1909. Tabriz type, silk type, 34 emeralds, 14 tourmalines, 1 aquamarine, 26 turquoises, 15,000 small pearls, 150 large pearls. Today, the $50,000 in dollar value, only dollar value, is $1.3 million US dollars today. There is another rug in the White House. And here it is. Woven with lines of 13th century Farsi poetry, Saidi, pseudonym Sheikh Muslih ad-Din, the top part reads, "It is a green leaf, a gift of a dervish. What can the poor person do? That is all that he possesses." And the bottom part, band reads, "To bring the leg of a locust to a king is improper. However, it is quite an achievement if an ant is brought in." Here it is. This is the first time you're hearing this. You see the emerald? and there is around them the tourmaline, pearls, large pearls, smaller pearls. You see the pearls? Tourmaline? Yeah, real pearls, yeah. And the gems are real. The emeralds and the rubies and the tourmalines. So if I zoom here for you, make it a little bit easier. See all the pearls, the white ones? Again, the gems, rubies. Back in 2012, the White House assistant curator wrote to me. She said, because the rug is particularly delicate, it is currently being stored in a secure climate-controlled facility. The age and the material of the rug has been fragile. It must be stored in a very low light to prevent fading. The rug hung for many years to the White House and was enjoyed by presidents and their guests. Unfortunately, hanging the rug caused it to pull and stretch in a certain area over time. Therefore, we now must store the rug flat to prevent further stretching. While we would love to display this exceptional textile, we feel that it is of the utmost importance to preserve it as best as we can. Hopefully, we will be able to display it again in the future, perhaps for a limited time, so that it may be enjoyed again. Another rug for another president, William Howard Taft, in 1910. The same guy, the same consul, Haygazun Hovhannes Sopakian, the Persian consul. Another rare rug for the White House. So we have three rugs in the White House. Armenian donated. But unfortunately, the consul of Anestopakian has incessantly killed yesterday afternoon when he fell 17 stories from the window of the Yale Club in Vanderbilt Avenue, where scores of people were passing. Mr. Topakian, who resigned the consul generalship in 1923, was widely known Oriental rug expert and a member of several New York clubs. He was 62. He had 48 decorations from sultans, even because he was from Kayseri. He was decorated by the sultan in many dignitaries. I would like to see all three Armenian-related White House rugs displayed publicly in Los Angeles. Do you agree?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Now is the fun time for questions. Yes.